Welcome to another Infinite Painter 6 tutorial. Today I will try to show you and explain all the controls of the brush editor in Painter. This will be a detailed technical description, so it will take time and may contain parts that are not interesting for you. So if you are looking for some specific information, in the description text below the video you will find links pointing directly to explanation of each section of the brush editor. The basics of general functionality of the brush editor you may find in my previous videos. This tutorial describes the Android version of Infinite Painter, but in iOS version, all the content and functionality of the brush editor is identical, despite the visual differences. Okay, let's not start from the beginning. The brush editor in current version has 10 sections, plus a stationary header with the brush preview thumbnail. First section groups main controls that affect the brush stroke in general, plus the name of the brush, which is of course editable as well. Then we have brush size, opacity and size range. Size and size range together define the actual diameter of the brush head. Size range works as a multiplier for size. So when at 100% of size range, maximum size is 256 pixels, at 300% it is 768 pixels. Size range value affects certain other settings like dynamic size ranges. In general, average single settings in the brush options interacts with many others and it is not always possible to demonstrate how they work in isolation. Like opacity parameter, which may affect most of other settings, for example, if set very low. Or the next selector, which is blend mode. Color blending mode of the brush defines how the color applied with the brush is being visually mixed with the background. As in Painter we have 25 different color blending modes, even the shortest explanation of how they work and what they could be used for would take a separate video. Let's leave it as normal for now. Next we have two curve graphs, which have been added recently in January this year. These are size and flow profiles of the stroke. Each graph has three section grid. The left third is the starting part of the stroke, the right third is the ending of it, and the middle section is the rest in between them. This tool allows you to add a nice tapered end to any brush, but may affect other controls like dynamic pressure controlled size. Similar graph for flow lets you control the flow of the brush along the stroke. At the end of the main section we have reset button that this brings you home when you got lost in the brush options. Okay, next is the sources section and it controls two most essential aspects of each brush in Painter. Its brush head or tip and the internal brush texture. The two thumbnails let you select new bitmap for each purpose or to remove existing bitmap. If you remove the brush head bitmap, the brush defaults to simple round tip. Brush doesn't have to have a texture, but adding one usually adds quality and realism to its appearance. Since Android version 6.1.23 and iOS version 3.2, both source bitmaps may be used in full color and with transparency. Also, there is practically no limit of the size of the bitmaps to be used here. Using color brush heads, you have to be aware that the color of the source bitmap will interfere with the color used with the brush and may be altered by many other factors, but the effects may be interesting. Below each source thumbnail is another curve graph, which is similar to profile curve, but has quite different function. It controls how the source image luminosity is used in the brush. It allows for basic tonal adjustments of the source bitmap without editing the original file. Next section defines the brush head behavior. To explain how the brush head works, I will use another source bitmap and let me start from spacing parameter. When I set it around 1, you see that the unit here is the width of the source bitmap. Above 1, the brush head bitmap is stamped farther apart, below 1, the stamps overlap. When I reduce the flow parameter, you can see clearly what in fact flow controls. It is the opacity of each single brush stamp. When I reduce spacing to near zero, the shape of the brush head doesn't really matter anymore, and flow gives us pretty good control over the intensity of the stroke. Now let's get back to the style selector. It has been added quite recently and gives three options: normal, glaze, and glow. The style defines how each brush head stamp interacts with previous stamps. So in normal, the stamps just overlap. In glaze, they do not build up color, and in glow, they add color of each other. With reduced spacing, the glow gives a nice neon effect. For most brushes, however, the style should be set to normal. Okay, now this structure parameter. This, in fact, is a special effect applied to the brush. In oil painting, this is called impasto. This is real impasto. In digital painting, generally it adds simulated thickness to the brush strokes. In painter, the impasto structure effect is not very sophisticated, it just adds a shadow to each stroke. With more appropriate bitmap, it gives more realistic results, especially if I use next control, softness. Now we have a subsection controlling the angular position of the brush head. The angle parameter becomes obvious when you understand that the direction of the stroke on this thumbnail is from left to right. Rotation controls how the brush head is positioned relative to the direction of the stroke. Tangent, or 100 position, is the most obvious as the brush head just follows the path of the stroke. Zero position is labeled fixed, and now the brush head is oriented relative to canvas. Minus 100 or reverse setting is pretty counterintuitive. The brush head rotates in opposite direction than the path. All settings besides tangent and fixed must be used with caution. Okay, now we have texture section. You can add the texture to the brush from here or from the sources section. Texture section provides parameters that control applying the texture to brush stamps. These settings interact heavily with other settings like flow, spacing, softness, so your results may differ. The most important setting here is the texture style, or the way it is applied to the stroke. It will be better visible when I reduce the spacing parameter. In fixed style, the texture tie is repeated side by side. In rotate style, the texture is oriented along the path of the stroke. In warp style, besides rotation, the texture is deformed in real time following the stroke path. It is better visible with this kind of texture. Again, fixed, rotated, and warped. The warp style is a powerful tool for creating special effect brushes. The depth parameter controls how much the texture blocks the color of the stroke. Darker areas in the texture block the color, lighter areas apply it. Interesting that if you use a color texture, it behaves differently, especially at lower depth values. With white color and zero texture depth, the texture paints with texture only. But when I turn off the color switch, the brush paints with pure white again. The remaining controls here allow you to adjust the size of the stroke and stretch it along the axis of the stroke. The X scaling or stretching works best with the warp style. The scale with size switch locks the texture size to brush size changes. The invert switch uses negative for the texture bitmap. The last control is structure. Like the main brush head structure, it adds relief effect to the texture itself. To see this effect, you paradoxically have to turn the texture depth to very low values. Watercolor section requires a bit different setup. I use here standard Turner brush preset on colored background. Using watercolor with transparency sometimes gives unpredictable results. Bleed out adds a watercolor spreading effect to the stroke. You can control the spreading by holding your stylus or finger pressed down at the end of the stroke. Glaze works as amount of the water in real watercolors. For higher values, the stroke soaks into paper. Mix in controls how the spreading effects interacts with existing colors on active layer. Dry out reduces the penetration of the spreading effect. This parameter works in opposite direction than the bleed out. Higher settings give more defined edges of the stroke, low values simulate painting on absorbing or wet paper. Next section is named Jitter, but could be better described as randomness. Each slider here controls how much randomness is applied to each parameter. So scatter, angle, size, and flow refer to the brush head. Hue, saturation, and brightness affect the color of the stroke. And the texture position and scale add randomness to the texture if one is used. Now very important section, the dynamics controls. These controls are used mostly if you have a pressure-sensitive stylus like Samsung's S Pen or Apple Pencil, but partly apply to finger painting as well. In general, painter uses three inputs from the stylus: pressure on tip, velocity or speed of the stroke, and the tilt or angle between the stylus and the screen. To utilize all of them, you have to use advanced stylus with both pressure sensitivity and tilt recognition. Currently, only a couple of brands support this, but soon you may find this technology even on cheaper devices. In the meantime, painter still uses velocity as a parameter, even if you are using your finger only. And on a number of tablets, it also allows for simulated finger pressure, so at least two dynamic controls may be used. Each control input may affect four brush behaviors: size, flow, scattering, and texture application. Texture dynamic controls are grouped at the bottom of the section, and they are of course hidden if no texture is used in your brush. Each pair of input and behavior is controlled by a curve graph, and it gives you very precise control over the effect. On each graph, the horizontal axis is the input from zero to maximum, and the vertical axis is the output, here the size of the brush, also from zero to maximum brush size set earlier. The shape of the curve expresses the relationship between the input from the stylus and the result, the actual size. So if, for example, I bend the curve upwards, weaker pressure gives larger sizes and the result is a softer brush. The only way to learn how to control the curves is to start playing with them. You have to feel how the pressure or the speed of your stylus is expressed on the graph. Soon you will gain full control over your brushes. It is impossible to demonstrate all the possible combinations here, of course. The tilt input may produce very realistic brush behaviors, like here with the customized Blackwell pencil, perfect for delicate shading. But again, you have to invest in the newest Wacom, Samsung or Apple tablet to enjoy this feature. One additional control for tilt here is offset. It controls the placement of the extra width of the stroke. Negative is outside the tip, positive is under the stylus. Negative tilt offset gives a simulated airbrush behavior. Positive offset simulates a pencil or charcoal stick. Next we have blending controls. These apply to interaction of the brush stroke with the colors already existing on the active layer. Dilution works like adding a solvent to the paint. So the brush lifts some existing color and the resulting color of the stroke is altered. Mix in controls how the brush mixes its color with the underlying color. Note that similarly named mix in parameter in watercolor section applies only to the watercolor spreading effect. The next three parameters affect brushes only in blend mode. Smudge defines how much detail of the existing picture is mixed into the brush head. In low values, it blends detail. In high values, it picks more detail and drags it along the stroke. Strength defines how often new colors are mixed into the brush. At low values, new colors are sampled more often, so they are shorter kept along the stroke. At high values, new colors are added to the brush slowly, so the stroke smudging is more intensive. The opacity here is of course a different parameter than the main opacity of the brush. Here it defines a separate flow control for blending effect. It is only used in blend mode. At last three sliders from this section may be accessed directly in the blend mode. Changes made here are automatically saved to the brush definition. Okay, now a pretty new settings section. Added in January this year, this Screentone. This is intended for creating halftone or dot matrix brushes. Once the Screentone switch is on, the brush snaps to a rectangular grid. The controls here allow for adjusting the grid. Size changes density of the grid, angle defines the angle of the grid lines. Scale with size adjusts brush size when the density of the grid changes, so the resulting pattern keeps proportions. There is one more hidden section of the brush editor, the particles. It shows up only for special particle brushes. Currently, in the default brush set, you have only two particle brushes. These are Svetlana and Pollock. You can create custom particle brushes by making copies of these two default brushes. Particle controls bring two new concepts, a particle and an attractor. In Painter, a particle may be any bitmap set as the brushhead source, so the particle systems may be relatively complex. An attractor is a virtual point that travels along the brushstroke that generates particles around it. Attractors may be considered tips of the bristles of a paintbrush. This set of attractors for a given brush acts like a brush head, so it can be controlled with regular brush controls, but besides that, there are special parameters that affect particle distribution and dynamics. This is how one attractor works. Two attractors, 3, 10, then I am adding more particles. The radius is the distance how far the attractors are set from the path of the stroke. Value 100 seems equal to 100% of the general brush size. Particle size defines the size of the particle, but in relation to the brush size, so for large brush sizes you can have pretty large particles. And the last parameter, overshoot, controls the dynamics of the particles on sharp turns of the brush stroke. All the behavior of the particle systems may be strongly affected by the regular brush controls, so effects may be really cool. All right, so we reached the end of the brush editor of Infinite Painter. I hope this tutorial was informative and useful. Please subscribe for more tutorials, and if you find my work worth it, consider supporting my channel. Thanks for watching.